How can we forgive 70,000 times 70,000? Saint Germain once said that before he made his ascension, he made 2 million right decisions. That's a lot of right decisions. Whether we forgive 70 times 70 or 70,000 times 70,000, I am prepared to believe that most of us have made that many errors. If we have made that many errors, then we can afford to forgive others who may have wronged us 70,000 times. In other words, if we are willing to forgive and forgive totally, the great law will bring back to us the balance of our karma and the transmutation of our sin. So it is imperative to forgive that many times. Well, we say this person was a murderer, this person was a child molester or a rapist. God has given us this teaching and this understanding that it is ours to forgive. It is ours to extend mercy, but it is God's to bring the judgment. And so God says, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, thus saith the Lord." So God always weighs in the balance the deeds of evildoers and brings them to that point of divine justice. We don't have to be avenging angels because God has created angels to do this. I have talked to many people over the years who say, "I just can't forgive my ex-husband who molested all of my children when they were young." God takes care of the justice, and we take care of the forgiveness. And that means that God is fair, and that the evildoer will receive his judgment, and that we will find that the mercy of God is the greatest healing unguent that heals our own souls, heals our relationships, heals others. Mercy is the first step on the path. Saint Germain has said to move away from the coasts. How far away must we move? I don't know. But I'm about as far away from the coast as I can be, and I feel very comfortable being this far away from the coast. And it's not because I'm concerned about cataclysm as much as I am concerned about pollution at the levels of the coast. The prophecies that have come about saying that there will be cataclysm, whether they will be or not, living in the mountains of Montana is a wondrous way for purification, communion with God, and walking and talking with Maitreya. This is Maitreya's mystery school, all of the land that we have. If you are concerned about not being on the coasts and how far in you should be, why don't you study under those who know, seismologists, those who deal with earthquake patterns, those who see where the faults are and who tend to know scientifically the conclusions that they have reached. I do not want to be a prophet of doom. I do not want to say the coasts are going down. The last time I was on the Pacific coast in California, the reason I wanted to get away was not because I didn't love the ocean and the people and the state where I have lived, but because in the presence of so many millions of people, I find that I don't have the ability to commune with God without interference of so many minds. I was walking on the beach alone, and I was listening to all the minds of the people, not only walking up and down the beaches, but in their homes, where there are thousands and millions of people. And I thought to myself, I can't live here anymore. It's too dense. I have to move on to higher ground. You need to find the answer to this question yourself. I can't give you an answer. The answer lies in your holy Christ self and your I am presence. I have heard the teaching that evil is not real and its appearance has no power. Please explain this. I have seen evil and it looked real. That's right. It looks real. It looks real, but it's not real. Evil is not real. The only reality it has is smoke and mirrors, a pretense at being all powerful, and at many times, very threatening. But to defang evil, you have to declare that it's not real. And when the devils hear you say this, that evil is not real and its appearance has no power, they are deflated because they thought with all of their pomp and their threatenings and all the things that they put upon people that we would finally believe that they are real. They have no reality because they cut their tie from God eons ago. We have to go after them as we were going after our dweller on the threshold. We have to go after it because they have a pretense to reality, and in the pretense of reality, they do very evil things. So what we are doing is we are stripping of them of their power, whether people in embodiment who are cruel and evil, whether those on the astral plane. When we deny this, we are stripping them of their power, and we are also impressing upon ourselves through an engram, through a pattern, that we do not accept that evil forces are more powerful than God. And that's the reason for this mantra. We have to know this and affirm it. Otherwise, we'll be in fear and trembling all the rest of our lives that evil has the power to overtake us. Well, even evil doesn't have the power to overtake us unless we give it the power. So we take the power away by saying, evil is not real, and its appearance has no power. That finishes them off right there. That's it. During a dictation, do the masters enter your aura and literally stand over you? Yes, they do. That's the answer. What's the best way to learn control of one's emotions? I think the control of one's emotions, of course, goes back to childhood patterns, whether or not you were taught to control your emotions. One thing that you cannot do in the control of the emotions if you are not balanced in the food you take in. You should be balanced in your chakras and in your organs. If you eat the extremes of meat on this side and the extremes of sugar on that side, you can't control your emotions. When you have too much yin, you'll be weeping. When you have too much meat, you'll be angry. And try as you will, you cannot control that because you means the whole body. The four lower bodies must be balanced, and that's when you can control your emotions. So that's the starting point. If you eat wrong, you won't control your emotions. You will just fly off the handle. You'll get upset. You may get depressed. You may get the sugar blues. You know, it doesn't work. If you want to be an ascended master, you have to carve out the right diet for you, beginning with the basic principles of the macrobiotic diet and seeing what works for you. So that's the first angle. I've seen it in my own life. And perhaps you've observed your own bodies and have seen the same thing. Emotional control begins with equilibrium in the spirit and a strong sense of what your body needs, what it does not need. In other words, don't self-indulge when it comes to food. You will pay the price sooner or later. When the angels wage war against the forces of darkness, can they be injured? Yes, they can be injured. Angels can be injured, but they're also extremely adept. They're powerful. They know their work. They move with the archangels. And they go out for certain periods of time within the 24-hour period. they go to the battlefront, the fresh troops. They wage war against the forces of darkness, and according to the cycle that their hierarchs determine, you know, they go back for an R&R, they recuperate, and they come out again, and they go again. What we know about the seraphim is they surround the great central sun. Certain numbers of them then hold a balance and stay in rings of light around the great central sun. Then it's their turn to move out and out and out, and then those seraphim come to earth, wage war, stay here for a certain amount of time, take care of their wounded, take them home, go back for the R&R in the great central sun, and then they come out again. So that's the story of angels. They work very, very hard for us, and we've been told that since the dark cycle has gotten darker, that Archangel Michael and his legions spend even more time in doing battle with the fallen ones than they have, let's say, in centuries ago. I've heard the teaching that our personal karma does not descend upon us until we are 12 years old. If that's true, why do terrible things happen to children? Well, children can make new karma. However, there is also a teaching that is given that in the acceleration of life and the acceleration of cycles that we are in on the planet, that many among us have received our first karma in our mother's womb. We may have been damaged. Perhaps there was a compromise and the mother wanted to abort us, and yet we came anyway. Or if we asked and went before the Lords of Karma in the etheric octave, the heaven world, before we descended, may we start balancing our karma immediately in the womb, the first year of our life, the second year of our life, so that we can balance that karma and work diligently at it, so that when we come of age and we've been educated and we have something to offer to the world, we will not have this karma tagging along behind us. So heaven deals with us individually. I think that's something that we all should understand. We are not just a mass of faces before the Lords of Karma. We are one individual who stands before them. And according to everything we've ever done and been in the records of the Keeper of the Scrolls, we then are given an opportunity to do what is the best thing for us now. And the way we make our decision, and the Lords of Karma make that decision with us, is that we go to the heart of our Holy Christ Self, we see the records of our past, we understand that we have left some unfinished business, left it undone, then we want to go back, we want to re-embody, we want to start that karma at an early age. Or if we receive a life's review while in embodiment, and we are taken to the Grand Teton Retreat, if for some reason the Lords of Karma wish to talk with us about our mission and so forth, we have that added impetus. So the older the soul, in my understanding and my observation, the longer you have lived on planet Earth in previous root races, and the more spiritual you are in your path, the more you will accelerate, the more you will want to find this path, this teaching, and finally determine that this, yes, this is the life in which I want to make my ascension, and I'm going to learn how to do that and see to it that I balance every bit of my karma. So there's nothing cut and dried about the, you know, waiting till 12. 12 is an age of puberty, usually. In some cultures, it's earlier, some later. But there's just no steadfast rule as to how this is going to happen. The whole society we live in has changed. Children younger and younger are on drugs and so forth. Is it possible to totally get rid of the dweller on the threshold while still in embodiment? It's not only possible, but if you're going to make your ascension, you have to absolutely bind and cast out that dweller on the threshold, otherwise known as the carnal mind. You can keep that dweller under key and lock, chained, like you would chain a wild beast. And of course, it breaks the chain when you get angry or you are off center. And so if you really have this one-pointed goal of getting back to the heart of your I Am presence, you don't let your body get into an out-of-alignment state. So the dweller on the threshold, we work on it with the archangels, with the ascended masters. The dweller on the threshold in most people is so powerful that we don't take our bare hands and go wrestling with it any more than we would wrestle with a dinosaur or a lion or anything else. We call to the archangels to bind our own dweller on the threshold, even as we call for its binding, but we always call through our I Am Presence and our Holy Christ Self. So the dweller on the threshold is a beast like any other beast of prey that roams the world. And so we have to be very careful, because the dweller is cunning. The dweller is like the serpent. What is the most important thing to do to help people who are dying? I think the absolute most important thing to help people who know that they will pass from the screen of life shortly or in some terminal disease taking longer is to bring them the teachings of the Ascended Masters, the Violet Flame, to acquaint them with the various books and shows we've seen of life beyond this realm where people have come back, near-death experiences. So if we can give people who are dying the Violet Flame, the calling upon the law of forgiveness, if we can talk to them about everlasting life. I know people very close to me, relatives and others, who just had the sense that there was nothing beyond because they felt guilty, they didn't believe in God, they had never gone to church, they had never gone to confession. Well, all of those things that we don't do do not help us when we have to meet our God. Why did God create the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the first place, therefore providing the potential for our fall? Because he had to test us. He had to test us. And the God that we're talking about is Lord Maitreya walking in the garden. And the garden is Maitreya's mystery school. And at the mystery school were many twin flames. And yet there came into the mystery school fallen angels who are called serpents. And so they use their rationalism, their rationale, thou shalt not surely die, which makes no sense whatsoever. You either die or you don't die. But the devil said to Eve, you know, if you eat of this fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, you will not surely die. But Maitreya had told them, you will die if you eat of it, because the reason you die is because you now have partaken of duality, the duality of good and evil, and two-eyed vision. So the cunning fallen angels came to corrupt the sons and daughters of God of the early root races. And we have a right to be tested because we made karma and did sin in previous periods of 2,000 years, going way back. And so we had to go back to Maitreya's mystery school. Maitreya's mystery school is not the beginning, even though it appears to be the beginning in the book of Genesis. The cycles go back much farther than what we have in our recorded scriptures. And so God had to test us because we left heaven. We left the realms of perfection. And when we were in heaven, we had the flame of immortal life. When we left heaven, compromised our souls, went through the mystery school, failed our tests, then we lost our immortality and we became mortals. And so we are here on earth because God so loved us that he allowed us to have remaining in our beings this tiny little threefold flame, 1/16 of an inch in height. And so God says, this is your divine spark. Long ago, this threefold flame was as large as your own physical manifestation, but you compromised it and you lost your immortality. So now if you want to get back your immortality, you have to prove to me that you are not going to break my rules. And I have sent you Maitreya. He has set up the rules, and there is a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And there's also the tree of eternal life. And if you abuse these, and if you go against my laws, then I will have to banish you from this mystery school. Since we are imperfect human beings, God tests us, and he tests us every day of our lives, not just in one final exam. He observes our thoughts, whether they are kind, whether they are condemning. God observes our feelings, whether they are loving or hateful. We are continually being monitored by our own holy Christ self and our own conscience. And we work through this day by day by day, and that's the meaning of becoming a devotee. You become a devotee because the guru has everlasting life, and you don't yet have it. And you want it, so you have to submit yourself to a guru. And when you do, he will test you, because you're not going to get into heaven unless you pass all these tests. And there's lots of them, lots of tests. I've heard that our souls can be fragmented. How can we know what condition our soul is in? The soul is fragmented because the soul has fooled around with fallen angels. Or the fragmentation can occur because of anger or any of the Martian energies that we describe, such as argumentation. And so the condition of the soul depends on the development of our threefold flame and our Christhood. If we have misused the threefold flame, if we have not grown in our Christhood, then we have become vulnerable to someone violating our soul. When we have the strength of our Christhood, we do battle with those who come to violate our soul or our body. But if we have squandered all of this, we have this tiny little threefold flame, it's unbalanced, and because Christianity has not taught us, we don't call upon our Holy Christ self, give the mantras to the Holy Christ self. We are not seeking to become brides of Christ, because unless we were Catholic, we do not understand this. And even if we are Catholic, we may not, unless we're mystical Catholics. So what has happened to us? We are naked. We're like naked souls. People have come along, they've stripped us, they've taken our life, our lives, our souls, our light. And where are we? We're defenseless, which is why we do soul retrieval 4 times a year. And we go after and we call to the great central sun magnet to come back and magnetize our souls to the living Christ. But when the soul comes back to the Holy Christ self, if the Holy Christ self isn't developed in us because we haven't given heed to it, then we can't hang on to the fragments of the soul that we have retrieved in a soul retrieval meditation. So this really burdens me, and people need to understand this. If you're going to have your wholeness back, you need to develop a very powerful inner strength, beginning with the Word of God living in you, beginning with the seed of the Buddha with you and the seed of the Atman. So our souls have a malady, and we were just told that the malady of the soul is the greatest malady that you can have, because the soul can be compromised if it is allowed to remain in that state of malady. So we not only have sick bodies, but we have sick souls. And we need the doctor for the soul, and the doctor for the soul is Lord Buddha and Lord Maitreya. So I can't tell you how you can know what is the condition of your soul. But if you have a deep ache, a deep longing, a deep pain, a sense of incompleteness, a sense that all is not right with the components of your life stream, you could be very honestly looking at the violation of the soul. But I have seen now thousands of people take this soul retrieval meditation, and they take it and they hold on to what they have retrieved back, and they build on it, and they build a fortress, a mighty fortress around their temple, so that if they don't have the attainment now, at least they can build a protective force field to protect the soul, to protect the heart, the flaming heart, and the threefold flame. So I tell you, it is something to leave the heaven world and then try to get back to it in a world where you don't find the right teachers, you don't find the right books, you don't find the masters, and we keep coming back and back and back to make that contact. And I can tell you that everyone who is here tonight is here because some master sponsored you to get here. Be grateful for that. What are the teachings of the Ascended Masters on dance? There are dance forms that are perfectly acceptable, such as the waltz in three-quarter time is the same time as your heartbeat. It's a very beautiful time, especially when it is understood and played properly with a long and then a short beat. But the real criterion is that if you are going to dance, the energies on the spine, from the base of the spine to the crown, must move up in an ascending spiral. And the reason why rock music is a problem, it is that it is a syncopated 4/4 time beat. It takes all of the energies above the heart down to the lower chakras. The lower chakras then become filled with that energy. They have to be expressed in some way. Because the music goes down, they don't get back up. And so what happens is that they squander the light. They have to release the energy that has come down, and in so doing, they find that they have lost their light. And this goes on continuously among our youth. And so it has changed the whole style of our mores. We have abortion because we don't know what to do with the energy when it is descended below the heart. And so people abort babies, they don't want them. And so it becomes a long chain of events. You know, if you really want to go up, then there's a lot of things you have to leave behind, but you know, life has its choices. Is it possible for an ascended master to fall as Lucifer fell? An ascended master is a son of God who has ascended back to God. He is God in manifestation. Lucifer and the angels were of another branch. They were not sons and daughters of God. And so their fall was the fall of angels. Angels can fall. And Lucifer fell, and he took the third part of heaven with him. What do the Ascended Masters teach on interracial marriages? The Ascended Masters understand that sometimes people find themselves in different races, but nevertheless it is necessary for them to be together just because they love one another, because they must rear children together, because they've had past karma together. Basically, interracial marriages are difficult for those who have them, but as far as I'm concerned, I cannot see what the problem is from beginning to end as to why the color of anyone's skin should determine anything in their lives that wouldn't be determined that way if we all had the same color skin.
You're watching Elizabeth Clare Prophet, world-renowned author and founder of Summit University. Summit University is located at the beautiful Royal Teton Ranch in Park County, Montana, just north of Yellowstone National Park. If you'd like more information, call 1-800-323-5228. That's 1-800-323-5228.
If we have all been embodied in all races and both sexes, why are persons currently embodied as black considered the sons and daughters of Afra? I think that perhaps the sons and daughters of Afra can speak to this better than I can, but it seems to be the necessity for a racial identity. Am I wrong? There's a certain identity that the sons and daughters have and should have by the very teachings of offer we received, in the solidarity and in the brotherhood that they share. Now, this is a necessity, as I see it, as we step further and further on the path. There comes a time when the color of our skin no longer matters, but it matters a whole lot right now, today, because we are fighting battles because of our race. And I'm talking about the race of the sons and daughters of Afra. So we have to defend our integrity. We have to become one great brotherhood of sons and daughters of Afra. And in doing that, we will attain our Christhood. And in doing that, we will also find this tremendous solidarity where our ties to one another and to our God cannot be broken. So it seems to be a necessity at this time, but it will not always be. How can we know if what we are praying for is the will of God? We always give that proviso when we pray. We pray for a long list of things, and then we say, I seal this in the heart of my mighty I Am Presence, and I ask that it be done if it is the will of God, and if it is not, I ask that it not be done. So we don't pray for people thinking we know what is best for them. We always submit our prayer to the will of God. You can never go wrong in doing that, and you'll never make karma by doing the wrong thing for someone. How can you figure out if you are destined to be married or single? Well, you'll just have to figure it out. I'm not a marriage counselor. Would you please elaborate on the difference between the initiations of the Christ and the Buddha? They're really not different. They are not different at all. Church Universal and Triumphant is founded upon the rock of Jesus Christ and Gautama Buddha. The initiations may seem different, but if you go to the mystics who are at the top of the lineage, who have the greatest attainment under Jesus Christ, and you go and you look at the mystics that are have great attainment under Gautama Buddha, you will find that really they both taught the essence of the Eightfold Path, of how we interact with people, the evil that we must deal with, as Siddhartha showed us. So it goes on and on. I think there's very little difference. I think it's the cultural difference that we see. The rituals that are done in the temple, what the architecture is, when people rise, when they say prayers, whether they go out and all work together and till the land, whether they are scholars and they go out and teach. Personally, I don't see any difference between them except a period of about 500 years in history. Are coffee drinkers trying to mask their depression? Okay, all ye coffee drinkers, let's confess here. I think coffee drinkers drink coffee because they have to go to work, they have to get a job done, and it's the fastest way to get your engine running in the morning. Maybe they are masking their depression, and maybe they're not. I don't know. What advice would you give to newlyweds? I think that the most important thing is to be forgiving, to not expect to be waited on and receive from the other something that is impossible, but rather each part of the marriage should serve the other. In other words, I would serve my husband would serve me. So it's a sense of service. It's, of course, based on love. And it's kind of nice, whether before you get married or after you get married, to just draw down some basics, such as we're not going to argue. We're going to talk through our problems. I think that if we expect to have our happiness, our fulfillment, are everything under the sun that we could ever imagine that would be the perfect marriage, we are in for, you know, a real blow. Because one day you wake up and you realize that you aren't in this marriage to be served, but to serve your beloved. And as each one serves the other, it's like a Tai Chi. There is an interchange, and there is a friendship. And to me, friendship is the most important thing in marriage. It makes a marriage very solid when we are really good friends. So don't expect too much of your partner, because I think most of us have not had schooling in psychology and the psychology of marriage. So give your marriage a chance, but always remember to be kind and to bite your lip before you say anything that is unkind. And then go on from there. If you're truly in love, your marriage should carry it based on those very simple principles. How do we know when dreams are real messages or warnings from the angels or ascended masters, and when they are simply reflections of our own subconscious wishes or fears? I don't know. You know, if I could get inside somebody's dream, I might be able to tell them. But people want me to analyze their dreams. And in order to analyze it, I have to go back inside the dream. So I really cannot comment on this or that, warnings of angels or subconscious wishes or fears. If you are in attunement, if you go to bed with your decrees, if you don't go to bed with heavy or spicy foods on your stomach and so forth, some of those very conditions cause strange dreams in themselves. But I think that the reason I have not been so concerned about these dreams is because this is not a religion of dreams. This is a religion of being awake and aware. What is the current stance of the Brotherhood concerning rape in regards to abortion? Concerning rape, there is nothing wrong with your carrying a child that is a product of rape, if you so desire. The child is life and may prove to be a wonderful soul. See, the soul is greater than the body. You know, if you think about the soul as having come through a situation where you are raped, we're thinking about the body, but it's the soul that comes to you, and it could be a magnificent and beautiful soul. How exactly does one meditate on and enter his causal body? The causal body are the rings of light that surround your I Am presence. You don't enter that body until you have made your ascension. You just don't go entering your causal body. You can meditate on the causal body just as you would stand before the chart and meditate on the chart. How do you get rid of selfishness when you feel it is almost dyed in the wool? Go to India and move with Mother Teresa. Go to Calcutta. Look at the people and the children who live on the streets. And I think you'll lose your selfishness quite quickly. Years ago, I encouraged my daughter to have an abortion because she was young. I now feel guilty and would like to know how I can best erase this karma. The best way is for the daughter to be happily married and have children and pray that she might have the child that was aborted. That is the very best thing that you can do in the situation. If the daughter is older and beyond bearing children, then you work with children, whether in a nursery school, you work with children who are homeless, and so forth, but you give to life in the closest form you can, in the sense of having had an abortion. At my job, I have two people who harass me all the time. I've been ignoring them. What else can I do? Be kind to them. Extend, not in a big ovation, but in small ways. Extend a certain helpfulness. Don't ever raise your voice. Always be kind. Always show that you're ready and willing to help if a situation needs help. Ignoring them really doesn't settle anything. It's just loving people. And if they don't return your love, it doesn't matter. It's an exercise for you to love people. If they receive it, fine. If they don't receive it, that's fine too. But you will have mastered yourself in the process. Is it better to stay in the presence of an abuser and turn the other cheek, or to leave? You know, this is a situation I know nothing about, but if you have an abuser and tried everything and all else has failed, you should move on, because the masters say if a relationship or a marriage is discordant, you are immediately making more karma than if you would just part company. So the ascended masters are not against divorce at all, but they also say we should know a lot about ourselves before we get married and then have a relationship in our marriage for a half a year or a year and find out that's not a compatible one, and then we go on to the next one. We should really heal our inner being, our inner soul, our psychology, so that we can be strong and supportive of our mate. How can I apply for direct chelaship under El Moria? You serve him, you read his dictations, you look at everything that he has said, you read his Agni Yoga books, you imitate your master, which is the highest form of flattery, you give his decrees, and you ask him, what is the most important thing I can do for you to be your chela? And El Moria will whip his pad right out and go down the list and say, okay, this is what you can do for me. It's great being a chela of El Moria's, because you always know where you stand. You might be in the doghouse. You might be somewhere else, but you always know it. He always lets you know. What's the most efficient way to overcome feelings of suicide and depression, especially when one is surrounded by such feelings at school? Well, if you can find a place, a corner, or when the weather is better, to commune with God alone, to strengthen yourself by giving a simple tube of light decree and calls to Archangel Michael. The idea is to maintain a constant communion with God that is never broken, because you always feed it. Whether you're saying your prayers silently in your dorm, whether you live at home and go to school, there's no way that you can really make it in this life if you do not make contact with God in a very strong way every day. For instance, like giving the violet fire and tube of light decree 3 times in the morning with intense fire. You've built a wall already. The other things I want to say is that suicide is a very yin condition, because death is yin. It is the last of ourselves. And if you are taking in too much sugar and dairy, as most young people do, this can be a major cause of your depression alone. If you are surrounded by such feelings at school or surrounded by those feelings that others have, and if you can, go somewhere where you can be alone in prayer, even if there's a school chapel. Again, you have to make the calls that you not be tied into this downward moving vortex that is pulling someone near you down into suicide. We have to fight for our lives. And I think all parents should realize that we need to make known to our children at an early age what are the threats to the very survival of ourselves, and to know these things step by step so they don't all come upon us when we're, you know, leaving high school or going to college or whatever. Don't underestimate how what you eat makes you feel bad. It's the very first culprit you look at. Why am I feeling so terrible today? The next thing you ask yourself, what did I eat yesterday? What did I eat 2 hours ago? It's not the end all of the situation, but it plays a major part. Call to someone you can depend on. In other words, telephone your parent. Telephone someone that you feel you can talk to. Don't ever be alone when you really feel burdened. But realize that the body, the soul, the mind, the spirit, the four lower bodies are a very complex vessel in which we live. And if we don't balance them, we can find ourselves vulnerable. How is one informed that he or she has passed all the requirements for the ascension? Believe me, you will be informed. Definitely. How can we overcome fear and anxiety? Fear and anxiety also has to do with diet. You can get rid of a lot of it by cutting out all dairy, cheese, all those yummy things you like. And fear, you know, this is anxiety, and it comes from the same place, sugar and dairy. And if you are vulnerable and highly sensitive and subject to being pulled to lower vibrations, beware. You have to beware. Lick that fear substance. See, you can't talk yourself out of fear when the fear is caused by the conditions of your organs based on what you've eaten all your life. Try as you may, you will always have that fear until you take from yourself the substances that have caused the fear. And that's what dairy does. Dairy makes you skittish and fearful. Are karmic records stored in the hair? Yes, they are. They are stored in the hair because we wear our hair every day. So as long as we've had that hair that we haven't cut yet, we have the records of whatever we did for the past year and so forth. Do you believe in physical ascensions? I think they have happened. I think that Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. I believe Elijah returned to heaven and so forth. But I don't think physical ascensions are the order of the day. As Chelas, how can we anticipate and prepare for our tests before they come? By studying the teachings of the ascended masters. Are there specific teachings that you have given which outline the steps and initiations that all Chelas must go through? An example of a test is when you are trying to make up your mind whether you're going to be honest or dishonest. In other words, are you going to do the right thing that you know comes under the laws of God, or are you going to compromise it a little bit and talk yourself into believing that a little bit of crossing over the line really isn't going to hurt me? So this goes along with this question. As Chelas, how can we anticipate and prepare for our tests before they come? If you know the scriptures, you know the laws of God, you know the teachings of the ascended masters, you will know the answer to this question. You have to read and study. That's why we have so many books, because the teachings are profound, specific, they're right on the money, but they don't get served to you, you know, on a silver platter. You have to dig for the teachings. And God prepares for us challenges and initiations. I mean, we see that all the time. We talk about our three main weaknesses, for instance. Well, if we get vulnerable each time we bump into those three main weaknesses, God is going to continue to give us tests so that we'll finally overcome these weaknesses. So I think that to be a Chela on the path, you need to continually be self-observant. And I mean continually. Reflecting on how you have treated someone, how you have spoken to someone, whether you have done something that is absolutely right in the sight of God, or you have compromised in some way. I mean, we all have a conscience. Our conscience speaks to us. Our conscience can warn us of these tests before they happen, but we often ignore those warnings. So you make peace with your Holy Christ self, your conscience, and you have that working relationship where you're constantly talking to your Holy Christ self, where you listen to your conscience. You literally stop and listen, because you say to yourself, now this thing I just did isn't quite right, and I just have to stop and decide what I'm going to do about it. And that's how we go along. We have to become our own teacher, our own self-observer. So when the test comes, we're ready. You know, but that takes a devotion to study the teachings. How do the Ascended Masters recommend that Chelas who are walking the celibate path deal with sexual desire without suppressing or repressing it? You have to watch your diet. Diet is major in this matter. You also have to do exercises, and you have to want the path. If you really want the path, then you can balance your body. You can also meditate and visualize the rising of the sacred fire. And when you have done this for some time, you come to the place where you do raise that sacred fire on the spinal altar. You can feel it rising all the way up the back of the neck and to the point of the third eye. So when you can accomplish that, you can see that most of that precious energy that you have is in your upper chakras. So when you keep that energy up, then the lower chakras are not stimulated, and the lower organs, because the stimulation is there, for one thing, from habit over many lifetimes, but from the other, for allowing that energy to rest at the lower levels. That's where you get the aggravation of the sexual desire. So if you are in earnest and desire to accomplish this, and you find that you can be happy and well-balanced and feel the strength of God and the fire of Maitreya coming upon you because you have this energy sealed in your being, you are on the path to liberating yourself from the greatest bondage that people know on this planet. And that bondage is to human sexuality. Others accomplish this by being married, rearing children, and God has said that this is lawful, and we know that it is lawful, and this is how we bring our children into the world. But if you decide to be a celibate, I applaud that path, because it is simply incomprehensible for someone to understand, unless they have experienced it, the tremendous amount of fire and fohat that you have in your body when you do not have your energies continually lowered to the base of the spine. So this is indeed something that all of us can conquer if we want to. If we can't, we shouldn't condemn ourselves. We should be married if we can be married, and we can consecrate our energies to the bringing forth of life or the bringing forth of a lot of work that we can do for community, for the masters, and so forth. So most of all, don't be rigid with yourself. Don't feel that you are holier than anyone else because you have accomplished this, or that you are a bad person because you haven't. But take the path easily, because really and truly, the path does not center around sex. So for this evening, I'm going to conclude, and thank you very much for being here. It's wonderful talking to you.
Been watching Elizabeth Clare Prophet. This program is presented by Summit University, Box 5000, Livingston, Montana, 59047, 5000. For free information on personal growth and spirituality, call 1-800-323-5228.